When a patient comes into our office and presents needing an extraction or some type of dental procedure, there is a classification system that you should be aware of, which will allow you to determine a general level of safety for working on that patient. And that is the ASA classification, so the American Society of Anesthesiologists. And it basically classifies people from ASA 1 all the way to ASA 6, and these different classes have different characteristics associated with them in terms of the patient's health. An ASA 1 patient is the ideal patient for your office. So these are patients who are very unlikely to have any adverse reactions to treatment. Now, these patients are patients who will have normal vital signs. So you'll take their blood pressure and heart rate, falls within normal limits. Their organ systems are all functioning normally. They have no medical histories that are significant. They're not taking medications. They're not smoking. They're not using alcohol, or they're using just a very minimal amount. And they are someone who can walk, say, a whole flight of stairs or a couple blocks in the city, and they don't have any cardiovascular distress. The other thing that's important with the classification system is it also takes into account the anxiety of the patient. So this ASA 1 classification means that patients are very calm in your chair. They have minimal to no anxiety. The ASA 2 patient is a terrific patient to be working on in your office. Now, you just have to keep in mind that they're maybe not as healthy as the ASA 1 patient, and they may have a little bit more of a medical history than with the ASA 1 category. So, what constitutes an ASA 2 patient? Well, first off, you could have someone who's ASA 1, but they're extremely fearful of the dentist. Now, if that's the case, they're actually considered ASA 2. So the reason being that stress is a huge precipitator of adverse events in the dental office. So that is one condition. The next thing would be someone who maybe has a mild systemic disease. So let's say that they've got well-controlled diabetes. So they've been taking medications for many years. Everything has been really good with their blood sugars, and they really have very few complications with this condition. That is an ASA 2 patient. Now, they could have another condition, say asthma or thyroid problems or epilepsy. Those would all push them into the ASA 2 category. Ladies, I'm sorry, but pregnancy also would include you into the ASA 2 category. Not a medical condition, but just overall, maybe more considerations when you're treating that class of patient. The other thing with ASA 2 people is if they climb a flight of stairs or walk a couple city blocks, maybe they need to kind of catch their breath a little bit. So they're maybe not as cardiovascularly fit as the ASA 1 patient. And I'm starting to wonder if I'm slipping into this category. I hope not, but I think I'm headed there over time. Eventually, I'll get there. I think we all do. Now, BMI is another one. So if you have a 30 to 40 BMI, the body mass index, then that could constitute you as an ASA 2 patient. Smoking is the final thing. So if you are a smoker, someone who's doing that habit, that is not a good thing, and that will push you into the ASA 2 category. When you encounter an ASA 3 patient in your office, you might want to take a step back for a minute just to reassess whether or not you're equipped to be dealing with the conditions that they're presenting to you with and any of the complications that may be associated with those conditions. So what I'm talking about would be someone who maybe can't climb a flight of stairs without stopping to take a break. Someone who can't walk two level city blocks without, again, leaning on something just to catch their breath before they continue. So this is someone who cardiovascularly typically isn't very healthy. They usually will have one or more moderate to severe systemic conditions that severely limit them. So one of those could be, say, angina. They could have a history of myocardial infarction. They could have mild COPD. They might be someone who has coronary artery disease with stents in their heart. These are all signs that you're dealing with someone who maybe isn't as fit or as healthy as that ASA 2 classification. Something else that would put you into the ASA 3 category would be if you had a BMI, say, over 40. So really obese people tend to have other associated health conditions, and that is something that we need to be aware of. Now, we talked about diabetics being ASA 2 patients, and that is largely true as long as they're well-controlled diabetics. Now, if you have a poorly controlled diabetic, or say someone with hypertension who isn't being treated effectively, or maybe they've just been diagnosed and they haven't yet got their medications sorted out so that they have good blood sugars or a reasonable blood pressure, these are patients that we need to be very cautious about when we're choosing to treat them in our office. The ASA4 patient is experiencing conditions that are a constant threat to their life. Now, if that sentence there doesn't tell you that you shouldn't be treating these patients, you might want to rewind and listen again, because this is a very concerning group of people to have in your chair. So, what they should be doing in your chair is they should be waiting for you to write out a referral to the oral surgeon, where they can then move on to someone who's a little bit more trained to handle any complications that could arise when these patients are getting their treatment. Now, they may even consider treating these patients in a hospital setting because their medical problems typically outweigh the dental problems that they're experiencing. So, what is this group of patients? How do we identify them? Well, if you ask them, can you climb a flight of stairs? They will tell you, no, I cannot. So, they cannot get up a flight of stairs. They cannot walk two level city blocks. They just can't physically do it. It's not they have to take a break, they just can't make it that far. So, very, very unhealthy people. The conditions they may be experiencing would be, say, a congestive heart failure that is fairly advanced. They may have a history of a heart attack within 3 months of the time that they presented to you. They could have severe or moderate COPD. They could also have end-stage renal disease. Any of these things places them in that ASA4 category. And what you'll notice is that they're in distress, even at rest. So let's say they've been waiting for 10 minutes in your chair to see you. You come in the room and you hear. You can hear them breathing. They're struggling to breathe. They're tired and they haven't even done anything. There's no exertion. They've had a chance to rest in your chair. They might even have oxygen on. These are signs that you don't want to be treating these patients and you need to pass them along to, like I say, someone who's more experienced, like an oral and maxillofacial surgeon. For the sake of completeness, we're going to talk about ASA5 and ASA6 patients. Now, you will never see these patients in your office. Reason being that an ASA5 patient is someone who is terminally ill. So they have something wrong with their health that is very, very severe that would expect them to only live for maybe 24 hours. So an example of this could be an intracranial bleed, maybe a massive trauma or some form of a ruptured aneurysm, something that's going on that is going to cause them to die within the day. Now, these patients never receive elective care. They might receive some palliative care if necessary to get them through to the end of their life. Now, an ASA6 patient is someone who is essentially being kept alive for the sole purpose of harvesting their organs. So, again, this is not a patient who's really even alive anymore. Basically, that is the end of the spectrum of the ASA classification. So, what we've talked about would be the ASA1 to 2 patients. Those are the ideal ones that you want to be treating in your office. ASA3 is where you should kind of put the brakes on a little bit and make sure that you're very confident in your medical knowledge and your ability to handle emergencies. And you should also have a good knowledge of their prior history of these patients to have a full understanding of the conditions they're afflicted with. ASA4 should be an immediate referral for you no matter what, because they need the care of a more experienced provider and even a more experienced provider setting like a hospital. And then, of course, ASA 5 and 6 are patients that we won't even be seeing or won't be needing to treat.